What's up, guys? Frank here with my man Stevic from 12 Foot Ninja, all the way from Australia, the origin of such great hits like The Selfie, Wi-Fi, and coming soon, one of the year's greatest metal records, Vengeance. How the hell are you, buddy?
I mean, it's hard to tell now, isn't it?
I guess so.
Like, what's the metric? You know, where do we... The barometer's broken. So
alive?
yeah. So based on that, I'm good.
Okay. We're doing well. You guys are one of the most unique bands in metal as far as I'm concerned. And, you know, we're here to talk about Vengeance today, an incredible record that pushes the envelope of creativity in, you know, so many different ways that we'll get into. But first, I want to talk about, you know, this is your first album in 5 years. And I want to...
God.
I know,
that
right?
That sounds horrible.
No. Well, you know, number three, first and five. I mean, you took a little break there, but I did want to bring up, you know, I think about like 2 years ago, maybe even a little bit more, we had a conversation how you were kind of burnt out, you know, and about things and the band in general and band stuff. Is it safe to say something happened to kind of reinvigorate this desire to not only make an album, but like to do it in fucking style right now? You
know? Yeah, I mean, that's a really good question. I don't think it's a binary on-off thing. It's more like, I don't know, when a problem arises, it's an opportunity to explore what's behind the problem. So I don't know, with that being too nebulous, I would say, you know, I looked really into motivation, like intrinsic and extrinsic motivation. What motivates people? Like, what am I motivated by? What are the guys motivated by? How different is it? And where's the common ground? And, you know, why do we do this? You know, and trying to return to some kind of, you know, to shake the Etch-A-Sketch and kind of return to some kind of blank canvas. And I guess, you know, find the joy. Because you can sort of, when a hobby and a love turns into a career, it has a way of sucking all of the goodness out of it sometimes, you know?
Totally understand that for sure. And I do love that you have so many different palettes and interests and stuff like that to kind of keep you, you know, afloat, to keep your interest there to some degree.
Well, I think that ties to that motivation thing. Like for me, I worked out, you know, I have to do multiple things simultaneously, you know, and I know like one thing that I really admire about you as a unique person in the industry is you're actually a really good musician as well as a, you know, dedicated journalist. So I think if you were only one or the other, you know, you might not be as balanced. Like there might be something missing. To me, it's the same sort of thing. Like, not to discredit or invalidate anyone who, you know, disagrees with this, but just playing guitar in a band isn't enough. Like for me personally, like, you know, there's too many other things that are enticing and stimulating and stuff, and you can go a bit crazy like if you know have these drives and you just kind of repress them for some, you know, arbitrary reason that you might tell yourself is discipline or something.
Personally, I always say, you know, being one makes me better at the other, and I'm sure you probably feel the same way as well.
Yeah, 100%. It's really funny, like when I was making the video game, I hardly touched guitar like for almost a year. But I was enjoying looking at it and wanting to play it. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like a weird version of edging. I was like, oh, I want to play you, but I'm not gonna.
Right.
And it just builds up. And then, you know, like I like to try and look at, you know, it's inspiring when you can look at something from a fresh perspective. And yeah, I mean, with metal, it's really easy to go down, like I call it the dark side of the force, where you just sort of, you know, you get preoccupied with technicality and lose touch of soul. Like it all just becomes cognitive, you know, like an Escher staircase, as opposed to, you know, something that is rooted in some kind of purpose.
If taking this break is what led to this album, then I say awesome. Because it's a great fucking record, and it has a ton of soul, and the music is there. You know what I mean? It's not just about the technicality. I think within the first minute of the album alone, you can tell like the emotional value of what it is, and not necessarily the technicality of it.
You know? I mean, it's honestly refreshing to hear you say that you like it, because for me, it's like, and the band, and I can speak on behalf of everyone in the band, we feel like it's like a painting pushed up against our face. Like we don't know what it is, like, you know, because we've been sitting on it for so long. And you know, another rabbit hole I'm going down is evolutionary psychology and what's going on with COVID and how that affects kind of our natural social interactions and hierarchy and value. Like it's, I don't know. I didn't think it was affecting me, but I definitely identified that there's no human feedback about like what we're doing. There's pixels on a screen, but it's difficult to kind of bank that. I don't know. For some reason I see comments, and I love some comments, and you get some people doing really heartfelt stuff, but I don't know. It still doesn't kind of have the same impact.
You know, it's funny. Everybody always has this term like going back to normal. And I'm like, I don't know that there is such a thing. Like you can't, you know, stuff it back in the bottle.
No. Well, yeah. I mean, this is an unprecedented time in human history, as far as I'm aware. Like, I mean, there has been horrible pandemics, but not interlaced with this kind of connectivity, so we can all share the experience.
The album does come with a 1,000-page fictional novel, which is, of course, very different, you know, but not necessarily different for you, a man who has done, you know, the likes of comics before. At what point did you decide that you want to have something like a novel, you know, to coincide with the album?
Yeah, it's kind of a strange trajectory, because it really began in 2007 when the band, like I came up with 12 Foot Ninja, this idea. And I mean, I was totally cognizant of the fact that the name is very comic booky and some would say ridiculous, because how can a ninja be 12 feet tall and all of that kind of stuff. But it was really an idea that kind of percolated in my head after actually going to Ripley's Believe It or Not Museum and seeing a life-size Robert Wadlow, who was like, I think he was almost 9 feet tall, like the tallest dude ever. And seeing him, and then I read this story about how he swatted away someone who tried to pull his leg off, thinking it was a guy on stilts, and he had this power, just like, get away, you know, like this crazy. I'm like, what if he harnessed that? What if he was dexterous? And then I thought, who would he be? And I just kept thinking about it. Anyway, so a story evolved, and weirdly, the plan in the beginning was to have, I don't know, I can't find a better synonym, but like a fable, you know, like a morality-based story, because they're the stories I love. And I love Joseph Campbell and the monomyth, and, you know, I'm a big Star Wars tradition, you know, the original Star Wars is like a complete homage to Joseph Campbell. He was George Lucas's mentor, and that really inspired me. It kind of, like, how do we tell this story? You know, originally we had it all on a Flash website. There was this big parchment thing that would move around. And then we're like, no, that's not right. And kept ditching it and going, okay. I went to LA and spoke to Titmouse. Sorry, I got this bloody frog in my throat. And, you know, talked about an animated series. And it's like, well, adult animation tends to be very funny. And this wasn't funny. Like, this is quite serious, you know, which people might find strange considering, you know, a lot of the stuff we do. And then I brought on this writer that I knew, Nick Snelling, to like help me with the pitch Bible for the animated series. And he started building out the synopses and the, you know, episodic breakdowns. And then all of a sudden he was like, he just kept writing and it kind of branched out. And then it's like that scene in Forrest Gump where he goes running and then he just keeps running and running. So Nick, like, we were like, why don't we do like a short form kind of novel to, you know, to finish this out? Cause I had like a 6-chapter novella thing. And he was like, no, I don't want to even look at that. I've got this thing. I'm running with it. And it was kind of weird. Cause it was like, there was an intersect where basically someone else became like a parent of this thing, you know? And there was this kind of like, oh, like I feel weird. But so long story short, Nick ran with it for like 5 years and wrote millions of words. And he went sideways and expanded this universe into like something that is only explainable. I think you could describe it like Game of Thrones in like feudal Japan meets steampunk retro future, you know, like tinkering with alien tech from a time from another, you know, like it's really a really advanced world. And yeah, it's huge. And we were going to release it with Outlier, but it just kept building and building and building. It's like, okay, we could, you know, should we, you know, is this a sunk cost fallacy? Are we like idiots? You know, like, you know, we thought all this stuff, but finally, you know, it came to the end and it just happened to align with this. And I wrote the Vengeance comic, or the graphic novel, I should say, as a way of kind of going, okay, this is the 12 ninja character. Here is a little bit about how this character came to be. Who is the 12 ninja? Why is it called 12 ninja? How does the band fit into this? You know, and then it's really about the multiple model of reality idea, you know, where there's different branches of alternate realities. So I was sort of playing with that idea that there's concurrent realities that overlap and how to traverse those, and 12-foot ninjas in one of those. And he's not, his name isn't 12 ninja, it's Kiyoshi, like, but a lowly kind of inhabitant of this, I guess, kind of junction area of transitional kind of people, saw this 12-foot ninja and goes, that's the 12-foot ninja. And that it's kind of like a folklore name for Kiyoshi. And that, you know, imagine trying to explain that to people. Like already I heard myself going, you sound mental. So, I mean, the best way to kind of get it is to just read it.
I mean, that's a wild story to know he's been doing this for so long. I didn't know. I mean, I thought like, okay, did they just like kind of get this guy in, you know, Nick Snelling, to do this in the final hour to like kind of amp up the album that's coming out? But it sounds like it's actually, it predates really the album itself.
Yeah. Everything with 12 Foot Ninja is, I think whether it's, I'm still debating my mind. Like we never do this is what we're working on. Like we just go, this is what we've done. And maybe that's not smart now. Like maybe people need kind of to know, but I mean, I just get so sick of seeing bands like big news coming. And like the other thing that I'm mindful of is that there is a chemical payoff. Like, if you say, you know, I've signed up to the gym, I just did my first workout, and oh man, I'm really sore, and you start talking like that, your brain tricks you into believing you've done a lot more than what you've done. Like you get a dopamine payoff of like, you know, it's, I think that's why a lot of talkers don't do, because they're actually jumping the step of actually doing it because they're getting the payoff. And often their support networks celebrate it and go, well done, well, you know, good on you. And they get all this kind of kudos and they haven't actually done anything. They're just throwing intentions kind of to the wind. So I think that's a real trap as well, is to, again, that the edging thing, man, you got to hold back. I'm not some sort of kinky, well, not that I'm aware of, but yeah, sure. I think there's something about rejecting instant gratification in this day and age. Like it's an old school kind of perspective, because everything is like now and instant and like, you know, but they do that test on little children. Like you can have one marshmallow now, or if you wait half an hour, you can have 5 marshmallows. And you know, they always eat the first marshmallow. They don't hold out if they just wait, you know.
I will say I really appreciate that you are a doer. I know that about you. You are always working on something, you're always busy, you're always surprising me with stuff. And of course, this novel and the album even is not the only creative expose that you find on this album. As the single Long Way Home was originally released through two fans early by beating that video game that you created. First of all, my question is, what the fuck? You know, I mean, seriously, I mean, what even goes into creating your own video game? You know, I know it's a side scroller, but still, it seems like a giant endeavor to even start or do.
Yeah, well, I had an inkling it was difficult, but, you know, like most things, I didn't find out how difficult it was until it was too late. And then my pride kicked in and, you know, I just had to see it out. But yeah, I don't know. I drew because Long Way Home was quite a challenge. That music video was a real challenge to create because we shot it all on a green screen and it wasn't really lit right for a green screen. So it required like a painful amount of rotoscoping, you know, to actually... and symbol reflections and stuff can just be nightmarish. So we you know, we had one of the companies that we had on board just dropped out, and then everyone else who was like, yeah, we'll do it for 30 grand. And it's like, it's a music video. It's going on YouTube. Like that we can't just, you know, like that we can't spend that. So luckily my mate, our good friend, Ben Davies, who's a maniac, he took it on and spent an inordinate amount of time sort of cutting out the backgrounds, and then I drew the backgrounds and had to work on the perspectives. And you know, because when you film something, you can't just draw a background, it looks really odd if you know, you've got to try and work out the perspectives. Yeah. Of how anyway, I'm like, I'm halfway to a video game, really. In reality, I was like one, I don't even know the decimal, like the smallest decimal breakup of where I was in reality. So I started looking into programs, found this platform, taught myself enough to build a kind of functional, because I'm not a programmer. So I had to teach myself like some basic, really basic programming. Programmers would be like, that's easy. But for someone who doesn't do programming, it's like, you know, the logic is hard to kind of click into. But, and then I sort of joined the community of developers and was like, Eddie, I want to make eyeballs like track a player's movement. And like, I keep getting this problem. And this dude kept helping me all the time. Like, and he ended up being an Aussie, Matthew Chalker. And I call him Chalky. And he, I managed to convince him to come on board because I was creating all the art. So I was kind of getting better at animation. I'm like, I've got this crazy idea and, you know, I want to have this character and I've got this insane puppet. And we did this. And he's like, this guy's mental, you know, but he got on board and then we just got it done. But yeah, there were, in the end, there were 1500 unique graphic assets that I'd created. And yeah, like I pretty much got addicted to caffeine in the process. Like we put it on Kickstarter and we got to 113% of our target. And now we're building a full length game.
You're going to
say that's now on the horizon of like, all right,
are you going to pay somebody else to do it? Or are you going to still do it all?
I'm going to do a lot of it. It's because I quit my teaching job. So now I'm kind of like a video game guy.
Wow, dude.
So yeah, I'm going to, And there's new technology, like even in this last 12 months, there's new tech that will make it easier. And there's going to be, we're going to do a Mortal Kombat component. So there'll be actually like a full, it's going to be basically Mortal Kombat 2, the same kind of fighting ability will be in this game, which is hilarious for a character like Bruce Nick, who's the, you know, the protagonist in the story. Right. But again, the whole thing I mapped out, like I did like a crazy person thing and I had all these post-it notes on a wall of like the story of who is this guy? What's his purpose? You know, what is he doing? What's the end message? And what do I want to say? So, you know, and there's a bit of controversy about how I'm, you know, some of the things I'm touching on or whatever, but I just feel a compulsion. You know, maybe it's a slightly fatalistic kamikaze sort of reaction to the current state of affairs or whatever, but I want to put this kind of in there. And yeah, it's exciting because it's kind of a little bit like playing with fire. And, you know, this might be one of those times. You remember Stevic? He was all right until he put that game out, and then yeah,
never heard from him again.
Yeah.
No, dude, I'm like I said, thoroughly impressed and always surprised, and that's big, man. And for you to fucking dedicate yourself to it like that is just a wonderful thing to hear. Thanks, the man. Album itself is, again, so fucking good. And, you know, in true 12-foot ninja fashion, it incorporates so many elements of sound, atmosphere, feelings, and you even get into territory like, you know, like Danny Elfman musicals on a song like Shock the System. How do you go about compiling this stuff? You know, is it a fluid experience from start to end, or are you literally just kind of like, you know, kind of like what you were talking about, post-it note on the wall type situation where you're just grabbing stuff and trying to force it together?
Yeah, I mean, I think writing this kind of music is like putting a puzzle together. Like, it's definitely not time efficient, because you really have to sit with things, and there's a lot of exploration. So there might be, I think we got up to 15 versions of one song, you know, just trying different, you know, what would that genre do in that, you know, how would that work? Or, you know, and also a lot of discussion. Like, if I like Shock to the System, for example, Russ, when he first heard it, he was like, oh no, man. I think it's a ping pong match between emotion and theory. So, and the table is creativity, if we can expand the metaphor. You have to, like, I really subscribe to the idea that the thing that defines humanity is our ability to think. It's not just our impulsiveness. And I think a lot of musicians have almost bought this kind of myth that you have to sort of be this impulsive, like, just let it flow, man. You know, like, whatever comes, like, that's authentic. But really, it's kind of lizard brain stuff, because you're not actually using the thing that makes you a human, which is your frontal cortex and ability to kind of rationalize and go, okay, you know, how does that make me feel, and kind of process the feeling. So that's what I mean. Like, that's what I think some people might find the methodology too clinical, but it happens in tandem with, like, the emotional intent. So you have to establish, what are we trying to communicate? Does this serve that message? And then what are the tools we've got available to do that? And that can be painful for the others, you know, because I seem to have an endless stamina to do that. And it can get irritating, like, to be on the receiving end of, like, what if we, you know, like, I don't know if that's working, you know, like,
yeah,
you know. And I think it drove Kin kind of crazy, our vocalist, just to sort of, you know, with everything going on, and then this dude kind of looking at shit under a microscope. yeah. But in the end, like, I think you get results, and I hope, I've got this strange faith, I would call it, you know, because I'm not a religious person, but I do have a weird, I would call it faith in a kind of universal meritocracy, whereas that if you do put enough effort into something, it will be appreciated proportionately and hopefully remunerated in some form. That's my kind of belief.
Well, that, I mean, is definitely faith for sure, because there's a lot of art that goes unnoticed and nobody gets shit out there. So, you know.
Yeah. And it's getting harder and harder.
I like that you put the effort in there, you know, and your guitar specifically is a very unique tool in, you know, the world of metal, as far as I know. Shriuk and Variax, it's, you know, with the ability to change literally everything on a dime, you know, your tuning, your sound, in the, you know, in the middle of a fucking while playing, you know, it basically opens up the world of writing exponentially. And it to the point it would give somebody option paralysis, but you seem to like make it your bitch, you know? does that actually tie in with the writing and the, you know, the avant-garde-ness and chaos of what 12 Foot Ninja is?
When you write like we do, which predominantly happens, writing and recording kind of happens simultaneously. So I guess I don't have that, you know, what would you call it? Like a virus protector on the, you know, I don't have a firewall in my brain that says, oh, how am I going to do that? Like, I just don't have it. It's like, well, let's just do whatever. Like, there are no rules. We can bring in anything and then we'll work out how to, you know, create that later. Well, I've kind of fucked myself because, you know, it's like if this tech dies, you know, there are songs I just couldn't play live.
Right. Yeah. That's
a lot of songs. Like, so yeah, I'm kind of like, I'm trying to create a similar technology separately to kind of protect the future of it.
You are a true artist in every sense of the word, because you're not just creating art, but you're now creating the tools to create your art, you know? So it's,
well, I think wild. It's kind of self-preservation. It's a bit like Tony Stark and his little thing. Yeah. Like with that he's fucked, you know?
I think they loosely based that character on you. So, you know,
maybe it's possible. I wish I had,
actually call you Captain Australia. Is that it?
Dude, Captain Australia would be like, oi, all right, cunts, let's fucking, what are we doing? Hey, stop being a dickhead. And he wouldn't throw a shield. He'd throw like a six pack or a fucking boomerang or something.
I did want to have a little fun, as if we're not having enough here, but with a little game of this or that. Do you prefer analog or digital life?
As soon as you said that, I thought of a clock, and I'm like, digital clocks are so much, like an analog clock is like, it's like, you want to know the time? You have to work out this puzzle first, you know, like, fuck that.
Board games or action figures?
Action figures. Yeah, I think board games... I get frustrated with board games because every time I play board games, the people really know how to play the board games, and the learning curve is like, they're like, you know, fucking wizard's got power 20 fucking whatever. And I'm like, I don't know who that is. There's too many semantics. Whereas an action, I mean, look at this. Like, would this classify as an action figure?
Sure. Yeah.
I mean, look, that is, you can actually get, you can take his head off. And there's a little tool that you put into his head, and you can change the direction of his eyeballs. Maybe it's part of the Genghis Khan complex where I like to control.
Right.
You know, little men.
If you had to pick one, would it be a guitar or a computer?
Yeah, I can actually write guitar on computer. Like, computer gives me a lot more. Guitar is like pizza. But a computer is kind of like a smorgasbord. So, I mean, pizza is awesome. But if that's all you could have, if that's the, this is what this predicated on, this kind of notion of one or the other, then I think long-term I'd get more out of a computer than a guitar.
Recording an album or making a music video?
I don't know. Yeah, that's a bloody good question, mate. Because you can't make a music video without recording an album. So one begets the other. So therefore, maybe making an album.
Vegemite or peanut butter?
Fucking Vegemite. And it's un-Australian to say anything otherwise.
Would you rather fight a kangaroo or have boomerangs for hands?
I'd fight a kangaroo. Got a bit of a thing against kangaroos. So, yeah, I think I would fight a kangaroo.
Would you rather create comics or make music?
There's a higher chance that I would get paid to make comics. So I'm going with comics. But I mean, that I don't want to make that evidence that I don't like making music. I love it. But see, if I made comics, I could just make music as a hobby and I'd probably be more prolific.
Stevic, it's amazing to talk to you, man, and hang. Everybody out there, Vengeance is out this October. It's a terrific record. Everyone go out and buy it.
Thanks, Frank. You look great, man, by the way.